Welcome back. Bad things will always happen. It's how we respond that makes the difference. Good advice, though hardly new. But when life turns tough, death of someone close, loss of a home or job, rejection by one you love, it often seems your pain will never leave, your tears will never stop. Bay Area author Sark has been through all of these and believes there are opportunities, even joy, in bad patches that won't quit. She explains all in her newest book, Glad No Matter What. Sark, welcome.
Thank you so much.
Let's talk about how you got this one name, because, you know, there's Cher and Madonna and now Sark. Okay, so it's...
Susan Ariel Rainbow Kennedy.
Okay, and you just figured Sark was shorter?
Well, the name was given to me by the author Henry Miller.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So I've written about it in my book, so it's a fabulous story.
I have to go back and reread that part. All right. Glad no matter what. There is so much right now that I hate to sound like, you know, I'm a buzzkill here, but the truth is that it's a tough time. There are people watching this show right now, I don't fool myself for a minute, who have lost their jobs, who perhaps are going to lose their home to foreclosure, who have to move the family, who go through all that, who've lost a loved one, who perhaps are in love with somebody that's not in love with them.
Sure.
How can you be glad through that?
Well, first of all, let's be sure to say what I'm not saying. I'm not saying be glad when you're not. Mm-hmm. How annoying.
Yes.
You know, mindlessly positive people annoy me. Mm-hmm. That's not what I'm talking about. I grew up with incest in my family. I was in poverty. I attempted suicide. So I've transformed and changed many things. I've also written, this is my 16th book. Mm-hmm. So all my books have been about transformation. Mm-hmm. I know that people are transformational change agents. And I now have developed practices and processes so that people can respond differently and better. So yes, we need to feel the challenging feelings, but we don't need to stay there so long. People are staying there like this long. Mm-hmm. I'm showing them how to get down to about here.
Okay, so suppose somebody's sitting there right now and just had a good cry about something, and it's not the first time, and they know it's not, that it feels like the tears won't stop.
Right, and that's what we always fear. But what we don't understand and what people don't understand, and this is what I'm here to say, when we can turn towards a challenging feeling for even 5 seconds and just say, sadness, I feel you. Mm-hmm. If we can acknowledge and turn towards our feeling, it will feel tended to, and it will stop calling for our attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a psychologist was here recently, and she said, you know, cry your heart out first. But what if it seems like you're not moving beyond that point? What if you're stuck there?
Well, people do get stuck.
How do you get unstuck, I
exactly.
guess, you
know? And I think there is a difference. There's something about dwelling in negative feelings or challenging feelings, mm-hmm. and then there's such a thing as feeling it and moving on.
Mm-hmm. So, does the moving on always happen?
That's yes, good. If you are skillfully applying practices and processes, mm-hmm. whether mine or someone else's. But for instance, in my book, I put a feelings menu in the beginning of the book. Mm-hmm. Most people don't know how they feel. So identifying how you feel, so feeling your feelings down to your toes, and that's part of crying your head off, mm-hmm. and then using practices and processes to keep moving. And that's what people aren't doing. They get stuck and they keep repeating the same stories. The house is in foreclosure. I lost my job. There is a time to repeat the stories of what has happened to us, certainly. Mm-hmm. It's important to say I'm losing my job, my house is foreclosed. But that time ends. That time ends and transformation comes. Mm. And we have the opportunity to say, my house foreclosed, but guess what I'm doing now?
Okay.
And it's something good.
Would you give somebody out there watching who is in tears or just finished with a wad of Kleenex there, you know, crying their eyes out, something to do today?
Well, yeah.
A practical thing.
Absolutely. First thing is give yourself a big, fabulous hug.
That sounds a little woo-woo.
It is woo-woo, but guess what? It works. And it's also, you know, my friend Christiane Northrup, who's a physician.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
All your endorphins will raise. Mm. You will feel like 10 good friends have hugged you, and you will then, you can have the opportunity to live, what I say, live like a full cup of self-love, sharing the overflow with the world. Mm-hmm. So then no matter what happens to you, you are unshakable in your self-love center.
You said a magic word just now, friends. How crucial is it to have friends around you who are either sympathetic or at least will lend an ear, and so that you don't end up also where you're kind of like a rat in a maze, where you're just kind of running through the same thing with everybody. I told you the story and I told you the story and I told, but you're not getting anywhere.
Exactly. So even more important to have friends who are reading a book like Glad No Matter What or doing transformational practices and processes along with you. Mm-hmm. So they're tending to their feelings too. So if they see you, they can hear you repeating a story that's in a dwelling way. They can say, ooh, it feels like you're a little stuck there. Want to come over for tea? Let's go for a walk. Mm-hmm. And let's write the new story.
Okay, so then you go for the tea, you take the walk, and what happens on that walk? They may give you advice. It may not be the right advice. It might just be somebody who's sympathetic but not necessarily wise about your particular situation.
Right, and this is how we empower, this is the opportunity to empower other people to mentor us. This is where you said we are all mentors. Mm-hmm. You don't need to go to a special school or a class. We all have wisdom. We all have things to share. It's free. So you say to a friend, I'm not looking for just solutions, or I'm not looking for just sympathy. Right now I'm looking for solutions. Do you feel like offering solutions? Mm-hmm. And your friend will say, ooh, I don't know, I think I can only do the sympathy. You thank her, you have the tea, and then you find the friend that can have solutions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what if you don't have one? Or more to the point, do you worry that someone who is reading this book is really in some kind of a severe, even clinical depression and needs professional help and thinks, I'll find my friends with the solutions, or I'll read the book, or I'll read it again, I'm gonna do this on my own, and not get the help that they really truly need?
Well, sure. I was certainly one of those people, and I had to get professional help and for quite a few years. But I stumbled and floundered and made all the mistakes and tried to do it all myself. And guess what? We find out if it works, because we don't feel good if it's not working.
Yeah.
So we can be glad more often. But it's really practical gladness. We're meant to live with all of our feelings in the middle, in what I call the marvelous messy middle.
Okay, we're going to leave it there. I just want to tell people very quickly, if you take a look at this, I don't really have time to get into why, actually, but this is sort of written, looks like a crayon kind of format, if you will. Okay, I'm not sure why you did that, but it's
all my
distinctive.
All my books are handwritten. They're written from my heart to your heart.
I got it. Okay, well, for more information about Susan Kennedy Sark, you can visit her website at planetsark.com. Could be a starting point for you.